this question, who am I?
Anybody else in this section, Brother DeWayne? ask you to pray for me. I am close to the Lord, and I try to live my life according to the Lord, but this world is hard. And I just pray to each and every day to be closer and have more of the Holy Spirit. And just get closer and closer to the Lord each and every day.
Yes, sir. Amen, brother. That's what we all need to do. Anybody else in this section? Okay. How about on this side? Jessica?
I like your prayers. I know most of us, a lot of us, have grandchildren that we're having help raise or are raising. And it's just hard the way the world is today to try to teach them the right way when some of the other children are doing the things they want to do and their parents allow them to do. And I thank the Lord that Natalie is in church and God's using her, but she still struggles with things, and he'll pray for her that the Lord will stay in her heart and have her do what's right and not stray away.
Ms. Norman?
Remember my sister and my brother-in-law. My sister has an upcoming procedure with her heart next week, and y'all pray for her.
Okay. All right. Anybody else on this side? Ms. Dars? Or Ruby, go ahead.
Let's just for everybody pray for our president, because he's really, looks like he's really in for a hard road.
He gets out there, we're in for a hard road.
Yeah.
And the Pate family, where the boy Brown, please pray for his family.
Okay. Ms. Dars?
I want to praise the Lord that he gives me strength every day to keep going. I can't give up. I got to keep on going because he's done so much for me.
Amen.
And I love him. And I thank him for all my many blessings and being so good to me.
Amen.
And watching over me.
Amen, sister.
I believe my healing's on the way.
Amen.
I had a few feelings come back. So I'm thinking that my healing's on the way.
Amen. Amen. We're all going to be healed one of these days, thank God. Amen. Praise the Lord. Don't forget to pray for Miss Dot. She's been having some sickness and issues. Still not feeling real well, so pray for Sister Dot Bradley.
Donna Wright, pray for her.
Pray for Donna Wright. Brother Donnie?
Remember Meridian prayer. She's been out of work this week. Sick with congested heart problems. Pray for Donnie and Donna.
Okay. Anyone else? Got a request? Anybody got a praise?
Like I mentioned a while ago, I'll be with my brother Sam. My niece passed away yesterday afternoon around 3 o'clock. And I contributed to what happened was all the drugs that she's been taking over the last 2 or 3 years, Haiti. Just pray for Sam.
Okay.
Tomorrow and Friday. Have received friends tomorrow night at 6-8 over at Lakeley, and then we're going to be buried over at White Plains Baptist Church in Goshen. And I thank God for your prayer.
All right. Anyone else?
Just remember Daddy and the problems he had in his face. Female
problems. Okay. Pray for Pat. Lord knows the need and all our physical needs.
Joyce.
Joyce.
I have a praise. 3 weeks ago, I had a doctor's appointment, and they decided to test me for leukemia. I found out today that I have no signs of leukemia.
And that Jason Brock, pray for him, and pray for Brother Rick Melton, who was seeing him yesterday, and he's still in the facility. And pray for him. Pray for it, Lord, will be done. Of course, continue to pray for others that are not able to come in church like they should. Keep them in your prayers. And of course, let's all pray for each other. And as Brother Dwayne said, we all want to pray for that we'd get more God in us.
Amen.
Get more separated, dedicated. And honor the Lord and serve him. You know, you look around and you see so many people today that are missing and staying out of church. And it's alarming when we there somehow tonight because they're not able to be here because of sickness, but still yet, they're falling away from the church. They're falling away from the thing, not just the church, they're falling away from the things of God. And to that, that should be alarming to us. And I'm glad, thank God, there's still a remnant, still a few that love Jesus, still a few that still want to come to church, still a few that want to live God and still pray and honor the Lord with their lives. So I praise the Lord for those that do that. Amen? All right, let's have the ushers to come and receive the offering, and we'll pray for these requests, and we'll pray for the offering and also for the service, and pray that the Lord will be done concerning his precious will. What a good God he is, what a wonderful Savior that he is. Certainly we need to lift him up and honor him today. And just thank him for the privilege we have to be in this house. Brother Dennis Bishop, if you'd pray for us, please.
Our gracious Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the opportunity.
Yes, thank you, dear
tonight, dear God.
Yes.
Just praise you and be obedient to you for what you have us to do, dear God. Just thank you again for your love and mercy.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
This time, dear God, we're going to receive these tithes and offers, dear God, from each individual, dear God, and just bless the tithes and the offers, bless the gift and the giver.
Yes.
And not one soul will grudge one penny they give to the work of the Lord, dear God.
Yes.
Thank you again for your love and mercy in your Son's holy and precious name.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, brother. God bless you. Keep those things in mind. Next Wednesday night, don't forget if you want to eat, put your name on the list for the meal. Don't forget, on December the 14th, the kids are going to go ice skating. That's on Saturday at, meet at the church at 11:30, or downtown at 12 o'clock, okay? So that's those that are going ice skating, that weren't able to go. There's some list out on the table coming into the lobby that has the name of the people in the church. It's a Christmas card list. If you need one of those, get it and fill out your Christmas cards, put them in alphabetical order, drop them in the box back there that's wrapped up, and Ms. Henrietta's going to make sure that those get them to their right seating area where people sit. She'll put them out for us. So keep that in mind and do that if you would, please. Don't forget Sunday. Please try to come Sunday. Bring somebody with you. I think we failed to mention Rufus a while ago. Let's remember to pray for Rufus. He's one that said he was some better, and that's good news to hear. So to keep him in your prayers, we miss all them that's not able to come and be with us at church. We sure do. All right, turn in your Bible, if you would, please, to the book of 2 Timothy, chapter 1. 2 Timothy, chapter number 1. I want to speak to you a little bit this evening on this thought. Salvation. It was the purpose of God. Salvation. It was the purpose of God. We're going to read 2 Timothy chapter number 1. We're going to read verses 9 down through verse number 14, if you would, please. Notice there, if you would, we read. The Bible says, who hath saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose. Notice the word purpose. And grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. But it is now made manifest by the appearing of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who hath abolished death and hath brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Thank God for that. Whereunto I am appointed a preacher and an apostle and a teacher of the Gentiles. Thank God. The apostle Paul was sent to the Gentile nation. By the way, you and I are Gentiles. Thank God we were able to get in. The Bible says that he came into his own and his own received him not. But as to many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. Because of their rejection of Jesus, thank God we had an opportunity, we as Gentiles, to be saved and birthed into the family of God. And Paul was sent to the Gentile nation. It says, for the which cause I also suffer those things, nevertheless I am not ashamed. For I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. What a wonderful statement here made by the Apostle Paul through the leadership and the guidance of the Holy Spirit as he penned the Word of God down. I like this verse of Scripture. I like this part where it says, I know in whom I have believed. Thank God for that. And I'm persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Hold fast the form of sound words which thou hast heard of me in faith and love which is in Christ Jesus. That good thing which was committed unto thee, keep by the Holy Ghost which dwelleth in us. God, we ask you today that you just bless the reading of your word. Thank you for the privilege that we have today to be in this place and for the purpose of worshiping you. Lord, we know that even from the now onset of time, Lord, that you determined that we'd be in this place. We're thankful, Lord, that we're here tonight. We pray for each prayer request that's already been mentioned. Number of folk that are sick, the number of folk that are dealing with the death of loved ones in their family. Lord, how we pray that you would comfort them and help them. May your will be done. May you bless tonight and bless your word. And God, help us tonight as we bring the things that we hope will help and encourage your children. Meet every need. Bless every heart tonight. And touch that one, Lord, that needs a special touch from you. We'll give you thanks, give you praise, give you glory. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
As I said to you a moment ago, I would like for you to notice that it was the purpose of God. Salvation was and it is the purpose of God. As we read to you there in the book of 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 9 down through verse number 14. I like what the Apostle Paul says in verse number 11. He says, "Whereto I am appointed a preacher, an apostle, and a teacher." And I say tonight, sometimes we have to be multitasked. We have to be able to do more than one thing. And certainly Paul said he was an apostle, a preacher, and a teacher. And can I say tonight, the Apostle Paul was very good at all three of those. And I say tonight, we need to try to be the very best that we can. And I believe the way that we be the best that we can was when we allow the Holy Ghost to dwell in us, as it tells us in verse number 14, the latter part of that verse, "And unto thee keep thee by the Holy Ghost which dwelleth in us." And I say tonight, if you don't have the Spirit of God in you, then you're not saved.
Amen.
You're not saved if you don't have the Spirit of God in you. And let me just say, he comes in. And can I say that he gives us many feelings? But the moment we get saved, we get baptized in the family of God through the Holy Spirit of God. And I thank God for that tonight. That's an assurance. And that's a way to know tonight that we have been born again and that we are his children. But we see that the purpose of salvation is a purpose of God. We see that salvation pleases God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse number 18, the Bible says, "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. But unto us which are saved, it is the power of God." It's through the preaching of his word. Now, I believe that people can get saved. And I know it's the preaching of the word that gets the job done. But I believe people can get saved by somebody witnessing to them. And witnessing to them as of the word of God. And say what the word of God has to say about it. I believe people can get saved in a song service. I believe people can get saved in a phone booth. I believe they can get saved in a car. I believe they can get saved at home. I believe they can get saved at work. I believe they can get saved at Walmart. I believe they can get saved out on the street. And it pleases God to save people, and that's what he wants to do. But it takes the preaching of the word. The word of God has to be presented in order to prove and show to a person that they need salvation. And God died for that reason and sent his son for that reason in order that we can have life. Not only is salvation, does it please God, but salvation also is the power of God. Amen? The Bible tells us that as we read in concerning the power of God in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse number 18. The second part of that verse says, "But unto you which are saved, it is the power of God." The psalmist David in Psalm 40 said that he was lifted up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay. In other words, David's saying, you know, I was probably as low as anybody could have ever been. But aren't you glad that Jesus can reach down further than you can reach up? Listen, we'd be unable to get ourselves out just like David was in the pit. He was unable to get himself out. He wasn't kept on getting himself out. But he called unto God, and God pulled him out of the pit, brought him out, put a new song in his heart, praises upon his lips, set his feet upon a solid rock and firm foundation. Made a difference in his life and changed it. You know what? He done us the same way. Because every one of us that were lost and undone and without hope and without God, every one of us was on our road to hell.
Yeah.
Let me just say this now. Not all of us. You say, "Well, preacher, I wasn't that bad of a person." Well, the only thing I can say about that, you're bad enough to go to hell.
That's right.
But thank God he rescued us.
Amen.
I like that song, "He Came to Me." I'm glad, thank God, he came to where we were. And it's only through the power of God that you and I tonight can stand and proclaim that we've been washed in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Can I say, the Bible tells us in the book of Romans chapter 1 in verse number 16, the Bible says it is the power of God, the power of the gospel that saves us. Somebody help me with that verse. It just slipped my mind. Psalm 116. Come on. My goodness. Well, I guess we'll have to turn. By the time we start reading it, we'll figure it out. 116. The Bible says, "For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek." Thank God that it is the power of God that saves us. And I'm glad for that. Can I say not only that, Not only was it the purpose of God, not only did it please God, and not only is it by the power of God, can I say also salvation is the plan of God. We see and we look at 1 Timothy chapter 2, we're right there. Let's just turn back. I have it written down. But let's read it together in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 3 and verse number 4. Notice what it says. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God, our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. That is the plan of God, that every man, woman, boy, and girl can be saved and birthed into the family of God and forgiven of their sins. So we see that that is the plan of God. You see, what happens after we get saved? Or what happens after salvation? Can I say that there are certain results and certain benefits for those who accept God's salvation and accept the Lord Jesus Christ and be born again? In the book of Isaiah chapter 12 and verse number 2, the Bible says, "Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid, for the Lord Jehovah is my strength and my song. He also is become my salvation." The word salvation just simply means that we have been delivered, or we have been preserved, protected by the Lord Jesus Christ. And thank God for the deliverance that we have. Once we were in sin, then once we got saved, we were out of sin as far as this world is concerned. We see here as we look at the results and the benefits of salvation, notice what it says in the first part of that verse. He says, "Behold, God is my salvation. There is salvation in none other." You can't get it in church membership. You can't get it in your statute as far as this world's concerned and how you stand with it. It's not how good looking you are, not how skinny, not how fat, but it's only through Jesus, and the salvation is only that way. And we see that, and our salvation is of God. We see that the plan of salvation, that Christ would come through the seed of the woman. The Bible tells us that. We're familiar with Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15, where it speaks first of the first mention of the Messiah that would come. Genesis 3:15 says, "And I will put enmity," and that word enmity there just simply means to be hated or hate. "I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed, and it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel." We see that as recorded in the book of Genesis, the first mention of the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, when he would put an end to Satan himself. Look, if you would, please, in the book of Hebrews, and let's read a couple of verses there in Hebrews chapter 2, verses 14 and verse number 15. Back just a few pages where we were. Hebrews chapter 2. I'm trying to get there too. Good to hear those pages turn. Hebrews 2, 14 and verse number 15. It says, "For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that hath the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage." That's the way we were. We were subject to bondage. We were bound by Satan. We were held in his captivity. We were held in his prison. But thank God, through the Lord Jesus Christ, God sent his Son. And therefore, there has been a remedy for those that need to be saved. And of course, that remedy tonight is none other than the Lord Jesus Christ himself. You say, "Well, preacher, we're not supposed to hate anybody." Well, it's all right to hate the devil. Amen. The Bible says that he put enmity between us. He put that hatred in there. And I believe it's all right to hate the devil. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 6, in verse number 24, it says, "No man can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God or mammon." You see, mammon is one that is opposed to God. So I thank God for that salvation that we have that came through the Lord Jesus Christ. And as the Bible says, you can't serve two masters. You know, it's sad to say today, but it seems like folk are trying to do that. They'll say this: you can't straddle the fence. gotta be on one side or the other. I'd say it'd be a rough thing to do to straddle the fence for a very long time. And some people today, I'm afraid that they're playing around with God. You can't play with God.
Right.
You got to be on the right side or the wrong side.
Right.
And it seems that sometimes, some weeks, some people are on the Lord's side, and the next time they're on the devil's side.
Right.
You see, you got to hate the devil. You got to hate what he's trying to get you to do. You got to hate the way he's trying to lead you. Why? Because salvation was brought unto those that we can be saved, and that we know beyond a shadow of a doubt that we can have peace with God and not have to worry about facing and trying to serve two masters, but making the decision to put Jesus Christ first and make him number one. We see the plan of salvation is not only the plan of salvation, but we see also the price of salvation. That Christ would suffer for our salvation. The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 53, you're familiar with this portion of scripture. I just got a couple of verses written down that I'll read to you. We won't take time to read the whole chapter of Psalm of Isaiah 53. But notice what it says, and you'll be familiar with this. It says in verses 5 and verse number 6, he says, but he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. And I thank God for that. And then it says in verse number 6, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. You see, there was a price that had to be paid. And of course, you've heard this all your Christian life. All the time you've been in church, I will say this tonight, there's a lot of churches today that no longer preach on the blood. There's churches tonight that no longer sings about the blood. But the Bible says without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. So tonight you say, well, preacher, you have a slaughterhouse religion. You call it what you want to. But I believe in the blood. I believe in the book, and I believe in the blessed hope. And I believe with all of my heart that you and I that are saved and have experienced salvation can claim those. But it did cost something. It did cost a price for you and I to be free. John chapter 6 and verse number 37 says, if the Son hath set you free, you shall be free indeed.
Amen.
And we said this a lot of times concerning even our nation, how that we have freedom. But let me just say, freedom costs something. And a lot of lives given in order for us to experience and have the liberty and to have the freedom that we have as Americans cost of many of people's lives. But in order for us to have freedom and have liberty in our spiritual life, only one had to die. And that was the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I say to him, to God be the glory and God be the praise. Then we see not only the plan of salvation, not only the price of salvation, but I'd like to bring your attention to this thought tonight. I want you to notice the pleasure of salvation.
Amen.
It sure is wonderful to be saved.
Amen.
When we think about being saved and the pleasures, we think about what the Bible tells us that we can have abundant life. Not only does it say we can have abundant life, but it says that we can have eternal life. And I believe that our eternal life will be an eternal abundant life, as far as I'm concerned. The day that we accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior. Proverbs 16:20 says, he that handle a matter wisely shall find good, and whoso trusteth in the Lord, happy is he. You know, so many people today, even when they come into church, it seems like they come in with a frown on their face. You just have to sort of kickstart them. You have to pump them. You have to prime them to get excited about something that God's already done for them. Things that he's given us peace about. And it's a pleasure to live for the Lord. It's a pleasure to enjoy the salvation. It's a pleasure that we have the opportunity to know him and to know that we're saved by the grace of God. Psalms 36 and verse number 8 says, they shall be abundantly satisfied with the fatness of thy house, and thou shalt make them drink of the river of thy pleasures. And that word pleasures there just simply means delight. So it's a Hey, it's something that we can delight in, that we can enjoy, that we can cherish, that we can call precious to our hearts when we realize the pleasure it is just to be saved and knowing that our sins are covered and under the blood. Psalm 63, verse 5. It says, my soul shall be satisfied as with marrow and fatness, and my mouth shall praise thee with joyful lips. We mentioned a little bit this past Sunday about praising. And sometimes we mention that a lot. I understand I do. And I think that's for good reason and good purpose, because we should. We ought to. We should praise the Lord. We should be happy and joyful and enjoy the pleasure. And just knowing that it is a joy and a pleasure to know the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And knowing what he's done for us and how that he's met our needs. And as we begin to see, as we look at Psalm 63, verse number 5, that word satisfied there just simply means one's filling or one has been full. Now, we just ate a few moments ago, and I think everybody ate till they got full. Just about everybody I heard say something said, oh, I'm full, I've had enough, I'm finished, I'm done. You ought to be that way when we come into the Lord's house. We get around the Lord's table. We ought to just get filled up, get full, and go out and share the things that we picked up in the Lord's house with the lost and dying world and try to be a witness and let people see just how wonderful it is to be saved by the grace of God. You know, sometimes the way Christian acts, you know, how in the world could we ever convince a lost world that the best thing that ever happened to them was the opportunity to be saved?
Amen.
Amen. They just see the joy and the happiness that's in our hearts and it's in their lives. So we see the plan of salvation, the price of salvation. We see the pleasure of salvation. Can I say not only my salvation, behold, when it says behold my salvation, do we have that provided by the Lord Jesus Christ? But when I see this also concerning my salvation, I see the fact that it says in Isaiah chapter 12, in verse number 2, the second part of that verse that we read to you a moment ago, it says, I will trust and not be afraid. Not only do I see my salvation, I see my stability. Thank God. The Bible says, I will trust and not be afraid. Now, I think we ought to feel more. And I don't think we ought to fear him to the point that he's going to come around and knock a big hickey on our head. Can I say tonight, he knows how to get us in line. He knows how to slow us up. He knows sometimes how to stop us. In order that he can talk to us, meditate with us, fellowship with us, and slow us up in time to show exactly what he's got for you and I to do as we live for him. We see, as far as our stability is concerned, we have the promises of God that we can trust in. Oh, thank God for the stability that we have in knowing that God has never failed on one promise. The Bible tells us in the book of Numbers 23 and verse number 19, the Bible says, God is not a man that he should be, neither the son of man that he should repent. Hath he said, and shall he not do it? Or hath he spoken, and shall be not made of it good? You know, God's always come through on his promises. God has always made good on what he said he would do.
Yes.
Can I say tonight that we're still trusting in those promises that he has made unto us? And what I know that all of us tonight can say that we're trusting is where he says he'll never leave us and he'll never forsake us. That no matter what we go through, that we have a Savior that's going to go through it with us and help us with it and be with us in every situation and in every circumstance. When we think about the promises of God, we are reminded that, number one, the Bible says in 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse number 4, the Bible says that they are great promises. I like that. Great promises. Can I say everything that God does is great?
Amen.
He's a great God.
Amen.
He does great things. He does great. His ways are great. And I thank God today that those promises that we rest and trust in, that they are great. And then also in the book of 2 Peter chapter 3 verses 4 down through verse number 13, we won't take time to read those, but let me just say this. Not only are they great promises, and I've already mentioned this, but they are unfailing promises. You see, God made the promise many, many years ago to Noah, once the floodwaters receded and the rainbow appeared in the sky, that the earth would never again be destroyed by water. Now, the earth is going to be destroyed one day, But it's not going to be with water. It's going to be with fire. The right opposite of what we would think. You know, folks, I believe we're looking and getting close to that point in time that could happen.
Amen.
You know, I know we're getting ready to celebrate Christmas. People are excited about Christmas. I like Christmas. I'm excited about it. Looking forward to coming around, looking forward to the things that we're going to be doing here at the church and so on and so forth. I look forward to all of that and how wonderful that is. But you know, we may never get to see Christmas.
That's right.
Might be Christmas in heaven. Amen. The other night, we went home after church and we watched a movie called Christmas in the Smokies. And that was a good movie. Clean movie. Not one cuss word, not one slang word. Nothing in it was sexual. Nothing, just plain, just a good movie. If it comes back on, you try to watch it. It comes on the Inspiration Channel. And you ought to try to watch it. It's just a real good, clean movie. And it showed things about the Lord. They referred to the Lord, referred to God, referred to the Christ child. It was just a great movie. Not many of those today that you can find. But you see that people today are not trusting. They want to trust into the other things and the other elements of the world. But God has never failed us one time that we can trust in. And that's what they were basing that movie on some part. They were going through a hard time with their father. And the old gentleman, which was the grandfather, the father, he said, you know, what we just need is a big old good dose of hope. Brother Mike sings that song, our hope is in the Lord. If we ever get to the point in our Christian lives that we don't have that hope, and if we don't have that faith, and if we don't have that trust, and we don't have those promises, it's going to be a difficult time for the that are Christians. And I thank God for the fact that we trust in the promises of God. We trust also, not only in the promises of God, but we trust in the provisions of God. I look around tonight, and I can tell God has graciously provided for you.
Amen.
And all of us have more than we deserve.
Amen.
Now listen, I know we don't have all that we would like to have. I know we don't have all that some other folk have and don't have the things that other people have. But let me just say tonight, folks, when we get home, we're going to get some of those things. Now you're not going to get new cars up there. Don't get me wrong. You're not going to get new home. Well, we'll have a new home up there for sure. But we're looking not on the material things, but we're looking on the spiritual things. And God, I do not believe the Lord will withhold any provision from his children. The Bible tells us in Psalms 91:4, he says, he shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. And then Proverbs 14:26 says, in the fear of the Lord is strong confidence, and children shall have a place of refuge. I'm glad that there's a place to go to. Oh yeah, we face problems and troubles. We face things, and sometimes we sing that song in the choir, and we get down to the bottom of the barrel. Even though when you get to the bottom of the barrel, there seems to be another scoop. There seems to be another opportunity to pour a little bit more out of the cruise of all. God always seems to come through just in time and right on time. Philippians 4:19 says, it says that my God shall supply all our needs according to his riches in Christ Jesus. There's some of us that we've been there before. We've been to the place that we didn't know, you know, was there going to be enough money to go around? We may not have enough money to go around, but there's always going to be enough God to go around.
Amen.
And God owns it all anyway. Amen. He owns the taters in the hill. He owns the hill, taters in the hill, cattle on the hill, and all the hills himself. I mean, he has it all. He owns it all. And thank God he's not going to see his children forsaken and begging bread. And I believe that with all of my heart. So we see that our salvation, we see our stability. We see that we have the promises of God. We have the provisions of God. And then I thank God we have the opportunity to trust in the plan of God. And that verse in Isaiah 12:2, in the middle part of that verse, the verse says, he will continually guide his people. Can I say tonight that the Lord has a plan for every one of us? God knows what we're going to face tomorrow. the next day, next week, next month, next year. Nothing's going to take God by surprise.
Right.
And if you just knew tonight how many times that he straightened the road out, that he's called water over the next hill to be cleared up before you got there, we'd really understand what the plan of God is for our life. There's some of us tonight that have had physical problems and issues that could have taken us out of this life. But because God had a plan, we're still here.
Amen.
You know, when you think about those of us that have had heart issues and bypass surgeries, and so you see, so easily we could have been taken out of this life. And in my case, it's been almost 12 years ago that I had, so it hadn't been 12 years ago, when I had bypass surgery. And when I was going through that at that time, I've told you this before, I wasn't worried, I wasn't concerned. Of course, I didn't want to die. I mean, I wanted to stay here, but I wasn't fearful of dying. I had peace about it, and I knew God could take care of it. And I said, if God's got something else for us to do, he'll let us stay here. But yeah, he'll take us home. I mean, how bad could that be? Even though I know we all want to stay here with our families and our friends and our loved ones and enjoy this time, but let me just say, I thank God that we have that promises that he has made unto us, and he has a plan for us to continue on, and nothing's going to happen to that plan until God, until it is fulfilled in God himself. I thank God for that. The Bible says in Isaiah 58 and verse number 11, it says, and the Lord shall guide thee continually. That means he's not going to quit. He's not going to throw the towel. That means he's not going to give up on you and me. Thank God for that. He said he'll guide us continually, and he will satisfy thy soul in drought and make fat thy bones, and thou shalt be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters fail not. I thank God that there is a river.
Yeah.
Amen. Thank God for the river that flows that God helps us with. So we see that God has a plan for you. God has a plan for me. I believe God has a plan for every person. You see, it's not what we want, but it's what he wants for us. And the Bible tells us in Romans 12, 1 and 2, that we are to present our bodies a living sacrifice unto him, which is holy and acceptable unto him, which is our reasonable service. So we know and we realize we need to be in his hand and in his will, that we could live for him and serve him. And thirdly tonight, I mentioned this. I think we need to think about our strength. Isaiah chapter 12, verse number 22, the middle part of that verse says, for the Lord Jehovah is my strength. I thank God for divine strength. There's a lot of times that in our physical life, sometimes we feel like we just can't go on. We get aches and pains and things in there now. Tonight when I got up here and I first stood up, my back was hurting. I thought I was almost about to get one of those stools and sat on it. Thank God I didn't have to. It seemed to be all right now, but it was hurting a good bit. But we see we go through those things and we have these things. And we know that we can only do what we do is by the strength that the Lord strengthened us with. The Bible speaks of that divine strength. In Isaiah chapter 40, in verse number 31, the Bible says, the Lord is good, a stronghold in a stronghold. Wait a minute, let me back up here. I got messed up. Nahum chapter 1, in verse number 7. That's the verse I want to read to you first. And this is right. Nahum 1:7. The Lord is good, a stronghold in the time of trouble, and he knoweth them that trust in him. I thank God for the trust that he gives us. Look, if you would, please, in the book of Isaiah chapter 40 and verse number 31. Let's read that. A familiar passage of scripture. The Bible says here, Isaiah 40, verse 31. It says, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. And they shall walk and not faint. We have that promise. We have that assurance. And it's not because of what we can do, but it's because of what he can do. And that's the reason we read that verse when Isaiah said that he is my strength. Not only did he say that, but not only is it a divine strength, And I thank God that it is a daily stream. Matthew chapter 1 and verse number 11 says, Matthew chapter 6 and verse 11 says, give us this day our daily bread. It's good to know that the Lord's going to supply us and help us and strengthen us and give us that daily strength that we need. Not only is it divine strength and a daily strength, but it is a determined strength. It says in Philippians 4:13, a familiar verse, I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. We need to make our mind up by fixing our eyes, our heart, and our mind on the Lord Jesus Christ. We will never do anything for the Lord if we allow circumstances to influence our relationship with the Lord. Don't say you can't, just say that you can. And have that determination and have that strength, have that stability that we can have. And then in the next part of that verse in Isaiah chapter 12, verse number 2, and the latter part of that verse, it says, he also is my soul. I mentioned a little bit about that the other day when I was talking about that we had, I'm thankful that even when we go through hard times and bad times, that we can still have a song of praise upon our lips. We see that we need to have praise and singing. Psalms 100 verse 2 says, serve the Lord with gladness, come before his presence with singing. We should have purpose in our singing as we sing unto the Lord. We should practice of the singing as we read in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse number 19. And James chapter 5 and verse number 13 says, is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any among you merry? Let him sing psalms. You see, sometimes we can be strengthened by just singing a song. And then this last thing, let me mention it to you. And it's found also in the book of Isaiah 22 and verse number 2, the last part of that verse, where it says, he also is become my salvation. I'm thankful tonight to know that God is not only my salvation, my stability, my strength, my soul. I thank God tonight he's our Savior.
Amen.
I'm glad that that we're saved in the arms of the Lord Jesus Christ. We are saved during times of temptation. The Bible tells us that he, in 1 Corinthians 10:13, that he, though we may be tempted, that he offers a way that we can escape that temptation. Sometimes we are often tempted through many things, sometimes through poverty, sometimes through prosperity, sometimes through worldly things. And we see that we're faced with those type things. And sometimes that will cause us to sometimes not have the strong patience that we need to endure and to resist temptation. But I'm thankful that God has offered us a way to escape. Then can I say also he's offered us safety during the time of trials. The Bible says in Job 23:10, he said, that he knoweth the way I take when he hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. Amen? Good to know, thank God, that we're saved even through our trials. Then we're saved even during our troubles. Psalms 46:1, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Job 14:1. This is the man is born of woman, and woman is a few days and full of trouble. And I thank God because of the change in our life, when he made a difference, when old things become old and new things begin to take effect in our life, and we became a new creation. I thank God that we have that safety, that we can trust him in the Lord Jesus Christ. So tonight, I hope and pray that you realize the purpose and the plan of salvation. I want you to notice the salvation, the stability, the strength, the soul, and the safety that is afforded unto us because we're saved by the grace of God. And salvation has always been the purpose of God for all mankind. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all could come to the knowledge of the truth. Let's stand and be with me. We don't have anybody to play tonight, so we'll still have an invitation. dedication, and God spoke to your heart, you need to come, just slip out. We don't have to have singing, we don't have to have playing. God's word talked to you, spoke to your heart in any way. Any reason, you need to come through the altar tonight, you can come. Meet that need that we have. Anyone need to come? Anyone? Well, it's good to have you tonight. Thank you so much for coming. Don't forget the announcements that we made. Especially don't forget tomorrow, those that are going down to Mount Calvary. Be sure to be here at church at 11 or be down at Mount Calvary at 11:30. And they'll have a meal. I think they start serving at like 11:45. Then leave after that. They'll have a door and course in the sanctuary there at the church. And it usually lasts about 45 minutes, something like that. And then we'll be coming back to the church. It doesn't last very long at all. Have some good fellowship. Get to see some folks, some friends maybe, that we might get to speak to down at the other church. So come and go with us if you can. If you have to put your name down, if you want to go, put it down. We'll slide you in anyway, okay? All right. Well, it's good to see you tonight. Be careful going home. And don't forget to come Sunday. Bring somebody with you. Had a lot of people out Sunday. If you could just think maybe who wasn't here, maybe pick up the phone and give them a call and let them know that we missed them. I know we had several out. And let them know that we missed them. And I'd like to see them back in the Lord's house on Sunday, okay? All right, so good to be here. Hope everybody had a happy Thanksgiving. Everything went well. Now we got forward looking to Christmas and all the activities around that. So let's bow our heads. We'll be dismissed, and you be safe going home. Brother Roy Finley, if you would you dismiss us?